in 1973, a Western that starred John Wayne, Anne Margaret, Rod Taylor, Ben Johnson, and Ricardo Montalban made it to theaters. That movie was called The Train Robbers. The story goes that after the death of her husband, Anne Margaret's character, known as Mrs. Lowe, wants to tell the railroad where to find the $500,000 in gold that her late husband, Matt, stole during a train robbery. She supposedly wants to do this to clear her family name because she has a young son that she's trying to protect. John Wayne's character, called Lane, convinces her to retrieve the gold so that she can collect the $50,000 reward offered by the railroad for its return. John Wayne's character rounds up some old friends to assist him in retrieving the gold in exchange for sharing the reward. The problem is that the original train robbers have gathered together a gang to try to get that gold back at any cost. They travel into Mexico in search of the hidden gold, and they're followed real closely by a Pinkerton agent played by Ricardo Montalban, and he's currently working for Wells Fargo. After a series of adventures and battles, they eventually make it back to Texas with the gold, where they have one final battle. Now, there's a lot of folks that criticize this movie, saying that John Wayne should have made a better picture than this. I think it's a really fun 90 minutes to watch with a super surprising ending. John Wayne plays himself in the role that his fans love the most. He plays a gruff, no-nonsense character that has a completely disarming grin when he looks at you. This all-star cast, which includes Ben Johnson and Rod Taylor, and they are at some of their best in this movie. Their dialogue between each other, their chit-chat, is just amazing. It just makes the film draw you into their characters. And then you have to have a beautiful woman as a vital component to these Westerns, and that's the character played by Anne Margaret, and she does a phenomenal job in this role. Then you got Ricardo Montalban, who probably has the easiest job in the world over and above his Fantasy Island character, because really all he does is watch and puffs on a cigar and goes almost the whole movie without speaking a word. You don't hear from him until the very last scene, and that's a very short-lived statement. Burt Kennedy directed the film, and it came from his own script, so it has elements that are real familiar to you, being like a long trek across a hostile terrain, which includes several men and a woman. There's a big shootout when they arrive at the locomotive, and though they thin out a lot of the ranks of their pursuers, almost by half, and they scatter all their horses, they still need to get back to civilization, which happens to be a ghost town with a set of train tracks running through it. Dynamite is then used to rout the last of the would-be thieves from following them. The fire that ensued afterwards levels several buildings, and this adds to the nighttime spectacle of the movie. And talking about spectacle, the cinematography in this movie is just completely amazing. That alone makes it a great movie to me. You stick Ben Johnson and John Wayne into the mix, and you got a really good movie. John Wayne, in one of his great moments when he's talking to Anne Margaret, encourages her to show her finer points, her curves, and her distinctions. He wants to bring that to the thieves' attention to discourage gunfire from coming their way. Now, you might say, what are you thinking, Duke? Why didn't you just ask her to wear a dress instead? But there's something about the tight jeans and the tight shirt that seem to fit the part much better. Now, I've mentioned a couple of times about how much I love Ben Johnson as an actor. For me, he is just an absolute pleasure to watch on the screen. He was born in Oklahoma, so he comes by his Southern Plains talk and the mannerisms he uses really naturally. He's always been real convincing in other cowboy roles, and in this movie, he gets a big share of the script. And I think that's one reason I like this movie so much. One of the highlights of the film is a long scene with Rod Taylor in which they talk in somewhat of a self-deprecating manner. about growing old. Now, this film has some great lines in it that are really repeatable. One of the scenes kind of sums up the John Wayne creed. It describes in itself just about every Western hero that he ever played. And Margaret tries to take some wind out of his sails by finding fault with him. She states that all you do is drift. He gives her one of these notorious looks that he always does, and he says, "It's what I'm good at." The opening credit sequence is pretty iconic and seems really inspired by all the spaghetti westerns that were done. The scene opens on a desolate stretch of railroad tracks with a few scattered buildings around that just look completely deserted. Wind is blowing clouds of dust all around, and you really do feel like you're kinda in a Sergio Leone Western. Ben Johnson stands there looking up the tracks and just waiting. You see a sign that says Liberty, Texas, and it creaks back and forth in the breeze. Then all of a sudden you see Bobby Vinton pop his head out of a water tower where he's been taking a bath, and he calls down to Johnson. There's been a total of about 3 minutes that pass, with the only sound being that of the wind blowing, no music. Now, the director really wanted to cast Jack Elam as Grady, but John Wayne didn't want that. He fought him on it, and he said he wouldn't allow it, because he felt like Jack Elam had stolen a lot of scenes from him in Rio Lobo, and I think that's the truth. Jack Elam always makes a movie better. I feel that that was a mistake that John Wayne made in not having Elam in this movie. They had Rod Taylor play the role of Grady instead, and he does an excellent job. The dialogue sequences are amazing in this film, and he holds his own with every other actor. It's said that Rod Taylor was considered for the role in Rio Bravo in 1959. In later years, Taylor would claim that he had been real good friends with John Wayne. Although there were a lot of people that knew John Wayne and disputed this claim. John Wayne got boogered up before this film started, and he fractured 2 ribs shortly before the shooting began. This caused him a terrible amount of pain, and he had a really tough time sleeping at night. As a result, the action scenes had to be kind of scaled down to accommodate his condition. But the tough-minded actor that he is, he refused to delay the shooting. He displayed the same kind of determination and sense of personal integrity that has distinguished him with his on-screen persona. This is the 3rd John Wayne movie to feature Christopher George. They worked in El Dorado together in 1966 and in Chisholm in 1970. Now, I talked a little bit about the cinematography, which is just amazing. If you don't like the movie, just watch it for the cinematography. You won't get any better than this. The cinematographer that did the film was William H. Clothier. And I hope that's how you pronounce his last name. That's the way it's spelled, and that's the way I'm going to say it. And he had really long-lasting ties with John Wayne that dated back at least as far as doing uncredited work on Fort Apache in 1948. Now, for Anne Margaret, she had a really tough year in 1972 when this film was being shot. This film was shot during the spring of 1972, between like March and sometime in June. In September of that year, she was almost killed and was severely injured in a 30-foot fall that happened in her Lake Tahoe show in which she was performing. And then she gets the role in this film, The Train Robbers. The only problem is there's a lot of horseback riding in the shoot. She's so excited to work with John Wayne, but she's scared to death of horses. She states that when she was like 10 years old, a horse tried to bite her at a carnival, and she had been just completely scared to death of horses ever since and had never ridden them again. Then this film comes along, and she gets the chance to work with the biggest Western icon ever, and she's scared to death. She doesn't know what to do. She confesses her fears, and the production company sends her to riding lessons with Chuck Hayward. He was a professional Hollywood stuntman who had doubled for Steve McQueen, Clint Eastwood, Yul Brynner, and Burt Reynolds. Despite going through all this training, and Margaret couldn't shake the fear that she had of horses. Her nerves were still on edge. She had just worked herself into a frenzy about it. And you can see it in the movie. If you watch her, there's a tightness to it. She's uncomfortable on these horses. John Wayne knew this problem, and he did everything he could to calm her down. He assured her that she would make it through this film just fine. She states that John Wayne was just a big teddy bear, and that he was fabulous, and that he really gave her the confidence that she lacked, and she was able to tackle the task of getting on these ponies and riding quite a bit. Their friendship continued on long after this film was done, and John Wayne even filled in for her one night when she was scheduled to appear on The Tonight Show and couldn't make it. She gave him a call, and he showed up to pinch hit for her. I tell you what, Anne Margaret is the only female member of this entire cast, but boy, what an amazing difference she makes in this movie. She lightens these old gruff cowboys up and is much more pleasant to look at than John Wayne, Ben Johnson, or Rod Tyler. I hope you'll take a look at this movie. I think you'll find it enjoyable. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll continue to chase the classics.